Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I haven't shared this scripture for a while, and I felt that it would be a good way to start our church service this morning. It is Psalm 100. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, as Monica just did. All the earth, serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. Amen.
Amen.
Let's have church.
Good morning and welcome to everyone. I'd like to make a few announcements this morning. Every Sunday at 9:30, Sunday school will be held downstairs. All are welcome. Bible study is on Wednesday mornings at 11 o'clock. Choir practice on Thursdays at 6:30. All are welcome. Today after the service, Chef Brad will be serving his famous brunch. On Wednesday the 20th, the One Board will meet at 5:30 p.m. And next Sunday at 5 p.m., Steve Burbick will present a concert here in the church. Kids Love is going to start up on the 26th at 6 p.m. And on October 5th, a new legacy project will be in concert at 7 p.m. Do we have any other announcements?
I have a lot of things to thank people for, but today I just want to thank the people that helped me with the parking project during the street fair. We made a little under $1,100 that will be used to help projects that need done in the church.
Many thanks to Anne for coordinating that and organizing that project. Thank you, Anne.
Yeah, it's a lot of work. It's a lot of work. And she does a fine job, and all of you that help her out, I'm sure she is very thankful for that, and so am I. I would like to expand a little bit on Steve's concert. He had asked if he could do a concert here at the church, and he just wants to share his musical talents and his love for God, so you all would come and support him and listen to what he has laid on his heart to share. I'm sure it will be a good evening.
I would also like to mention that the flowers by the baptismal font are in memory of Matt Venner. If there's no more announcements, so please join me in the opening. Oh, Karen.
This coming Tuesday will be Sally Bricker's 97th
great things.
Our opening hymn this morning is number 64, Holy, Holy, Holy. We stand as you are able.
And many more. Judy, did you have your email?
Yes, so Dave, the other thing.
Yep. Yep, and Bob. Those of you that have not heard, Bob tested positive for COVID, but he's doing good. I called him yesterday and he sounded a lot better than he did the day before, so he's doing well.
And then Jeanette.
And Jeanette, yep. Okay, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we have so much to be thankful for because of you. That is why we are here today, because we have seen you in our lives and we want more of you. We come together to worship you. We come together to sing praises to you. We long for the day when every knee shall bow and praise your name. May we reflect that here today so that we may experience your kingdom here on earth. We hear your word, and you have helped us to know that it is true by the whisper of your spirit to our heart. Trust me. It is you that we can fully trust. And we thank you for always being there for us. There are some that are struggling more than usual today, so we ask that you come alongside them. Allow them to feel your presence and help them to trust in you as they walk through the new journey that you have for them. If we look close enough, we will see where you have walked alongside us. You held us up when we felt we could no longer do it. You washed away our sins and have given us another day to make things right. You have given us the courage to do the things we would never have thought we would or could do. You helped us to provide for ourselves or for our families when we thought that it wasn't possible. You helped us walk through grief, loneliness, the unknown, and so much more. And with every step, you showed us how everything is possible with you. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for caring for us. And thank you for never giving up on us. May we have the desire to continually follow you as you lead us down that straight and narrow path, the path that will get us to the final destination that you have prepared for us. Not only will it bring us to eternal life that you have promised us, but it will make our life this side of heaven easier to manage. There are those that continue to need your healing. We continue to lift Betty and Bob Belding, Jeanette Van Pelt, Dorothy and John Marion, Inez Corey, Wilma Hunt, Leland Mackle, Becky McMurray, Cheryl and Lowell's son-in-law Tom, Patty. There are others that we left to you in silence. We bring these to you because they have been laid on our hearts to ask the great physician for his favor in them. We know that you have already been walking and talking with them. We pray that they feel your special touch today, bringing them the strength to continue on. We join Bill and Sherry in praising your name for the celebration of their anniversary. And we do ask for many more. We thank you for Sally Bricker and allowing her to continue on. Soon it will be her 97th birthday, and we would like to thank you for allowing us to be part of her life and her part of ours. We thank you for the things that she has accomplished, and we ask that you continue to drive her with the desire to continue to do for you. have created a great church family here, and we praise your name for that. May you continue to guide us so that we continue to grow in you and for you. For it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. If you would join with me in praying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Join with me now in the prayer of dedication. Generous God, you have given so much to us in love and joy. Every good thing in our life reflects your care. Even in the giving of our offerings, we have tried to give our best, but knowing we could do more. In a world where forgiveness has become a rare commodity, it is often an asset.
Thank you.
Testament reading today comes from the book of Exodus, chapter 14, verses 19 through 31. Then the angel of God, who went before the host of Israel, moved and went behind them, and the pillar of cloud moved from before them and stood behind them, coming between the host of Egypt and the host of Israel. And there was the cloud and the darkness, and the night passed without one coming near the other all night. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord drove the sea back by a strong east wind all night, and made the sea dry land, and the waters were divided. And the people of Israel went into the midst of the sea on dry ground, the waters being a wall to them on their right and on their left. The Egyptians pursued and went in after them into the midst of the sea, all Pharaoh's horses, his chariots, and his horsemen. And in the morning watch, the Lord of the pillar of fire and of cloud looked down upon the host of the Egyptians and discomfited the host of the Egyptians, clogging their chariot wheels so that they drove heavily. And the Egyptians said, "Let us flee from before Israel, for the Lord fights for them against the Egyptians." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea, that the water may come back upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots and upon their horsemen." So Moses stretched forth his hand over the sea, and the sea returned to its wonted flow when the morning appeared. And the Egyptians fled into it, and the Lord routed the Egyptians in the midst of the sea. The waters returned and covered the chariots and the horsemen and all the hosts of Pharaoh that had followed them into the sea. Not so much as one of them remained. But the people of Israel walked on dry ground through the sea, the waters being a wall to them on their right hand and on their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel that day from the hand of the Egyptians. And Israel saw the Egyptians dead upon the seashore. And Israel saw the great work which the Lord did against the Egyptians. And the people feared the Lord. And they believed in the Lord and in his servant Moses. Here ends the reading for today.
And the gospel reading today comes from Matthew chapter 18, verses 21 through 35. Then Peter came to him and said, "Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Up to seven times?" Jesus said to him, "I do not say to you up to seven times, but up to 70 times seven. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a certain king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. And when he had begun to settle accounts, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. But as he was not able to pay, his master commanded that he be sold, with his wife and children and all that he had, and that payment be made. The servant therefore fell down before him, saying, 'Master, have patience with me, and I will pay you all.' And the master of that servant was moved with compassion, released him and forgave him the debt. But that servant went out and found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. And he laid hands on him and took him by the throat, saying, 'Pay me what you owe.' So his fellow servant fell down at his feet and begged him, saying, 'Have patience with me and I will pay you all.' And he would not, but went and threw him into prison till he should pay the debt. So when his fellow servants saw what he had done, they were very grieved and came and told their master all that had been done. Then his master, after he had called him, said to him, 'You wicked servant, I forgave you all the debt because you begged me. Should you not also have had compassion on your fellow servant, just as I had pity on you?' And his master was angry and delivered him to the torturers until he should pay all that was due to him. So my heavenly Father also will do to you if each of you from his heart does not forgive his brother his trespasses." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Amen.
Thanks be to God.
The Old Testament story is an amazing story, amen? My question to you is, has the Holy Spirit spoken to your heart and telling you that it is true? Did you ever question that story? I know I have not. When I read the stories in the Word of God, I believe them wholeheartedly. Could you imagine this? The Israelites were set free by Pharaoh. And Pharaoh here is a good example of the evil one. See, he set God's people free, and then he changed his mind. And he sent his chariots, his armies after them and said, "Bring them back." That's what the devil does. Right? He promises us these great things, but he never lives up to his promises, but God does. Amen? And the amazing thing that these Israelites experience this day, how could they forget that? I mean, they're standing in front of the Red Sea, a great body of water. They're stuck between this body of water and knowing that the Egyptian army is coming after them. And if we remember the story before this, there was some grumbling going on. Remember? Israelites liked to grumble. They were thought, "Oh my goodness, you led us to this body of water just so that we can die? We could have done that in Egypt." God told Moses to hold up his staff. And Moses listened and he held up that staff in front of that body of water and God separated the water. The Israelites saw this body of water just separate. And we had a good visual for those of us that have watched the Ten Commandments, right? Of how that body of water just opened up. And the more amazing thing, and I know I say this all the time because I think it is amazing, is the land was dry. The land was dry so that they could go across. And they did. They got to the other side. But the Egyptians were following through. But did you notice in the first, I never noticed it say this before, but the wheels on the chariots were caught up like it turned into mud again. And the mud got caught up in all the wheels so much that they probably fell off, making it harder for the Egyptians to even get across. then God told Moses, once the Israelites all got to the other side, to hold up your staff again. And when he did, God closed the waters on the Egyptian army, not leaving one. We hear this great story, and we know the stories ahead. The Israelites had seen this great, amazing thing and how powerful their God was. And they still got to a point where they doubted. And in my mind, I'm like, how could you do that? How could you do that? How could you see such an amazing thing and doubt your God? Doubt his intent. Doubt his power. I don't know how you could do it, but God's people does it over and over again. Amen? We go to our gospel reading, and it talks about Peter asking Jesus, how many times do I have to forgive my brother? And he thought he was doing a good job when he asked Jesus if he should forgive him 7 times. Because in my studies and preparing for the message, I heard that the rabbis taught that you should do it 3 times. So Peter thought he was doing a good job when he upped it to 7. And Jesus said, oh no, not 7, but 70 times 7. And I don't believe they had calculators back then, so Peter couldn't like go in his pocket and pick out the calculator and said, 490? What Peter thought was, oh my goodness, that's a lot. And how are we going to keep record of that? That's the point. That was the point. You're not supposed to keep record of it. As a matter of fact, in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, when it talks about love, in chapter 13, verse 5, tells us that there is no record of wrong when you love somebody. You don't keep records of the wrong. You just continue to love. And think about that. You heard the saying, kill them with kindness, right? When people are hurting you or they're your enemies, kill them with kindness, right? And the reason why is because if you just retaliated and you just condemned them for what they were doing, you bring the worst out of them. Think about that. But if you love them, over and over and over again, you bring the best out of them. And when I was thinking about that, I was thinking about Victoria, because, and I haven't shared a Victoria story for a while, but Victoria, she's fearful of making mistakes. She even told me there was a paper we had to do in school, and it says, I'm nervous about, and then you're supposed to fill in the blank, in second grade. And I asked her what she was nervous about, which I actually was wondering if she was going to know what the word nervous even meant. But she said she was nervous about getting in trouble. I said, why are you nervous about getting in trouble? She said, because I make a lot of mistakes. But she makes mistakes at home where she, you know, has an accident, like spills her cereal or something, and she's always telling me what she did, and I said, it's okay. And she always answers with a question mark, it's okay? I always tell her, yes, it's okay, but we have to learn to try harder not to do that again, right? I think that's a good example of what we should do with those that do us wrong, amen? do us wrong, or somebody that makes a mistake, or, you know, we don't look at the bad things. We tell them it's okay. They come to us and ask for forgiveness. We say it's okay. You are forgiven. You are forgiven. And we truly mean it, and they feel it. And sooner or later, they'll realize that they are loved. Unconditionally. Because that is the way that God loves. Amen. Limitless. The parable that Jesus shared about the person that owed money and was forgiven the debt. And then went out and literally found somebody that owed them and grabbed them by the throat. Grabbed them by the throat and said, give me what you owe. After they had just been forgiven. Jesus said that you have to forgive. Because if you don't, then you're going to be forgiven like you forgave. You see, that person that was forgiven in the beginning ended up back in prison because he didn't know how to forgive. One of the things that we have to remember is that we have been forgiven. And I believe after reading this and after doing a little bit of studying, I believe that the only way that we are going to understand true forgiveness is when we forgive like we have been forgiven. And I believe that that's the reason why we're hearing this parable today. Not to say that we lose our spot in heaven if we don't forgive, but more so that we need to humble ourselves and forgive like we have been forgiven. It talks about this person being in prison. When we don't forgive, we are living in our own personal prison. Think about that. Because instead of living your life happily, you're living your life trying to figure out how to get back at that person that just did you wrong. You waste your time and your energy on thinking about how somebody did you wrong. Do you ever meet anybody or have you been in a spot where you didn't forgive and you were in that prison until you finally did forgive? I do believe when I was younger, I used to get mad at people that hurt me. I used to get angry. As I got older and more mature, I realized that that was just a waste of energy. A waste of my time and a waste of energy to be angry at somebody that didn't even know I was angry at them. Live your life showing love. Don't put yourself in that prison where you just think about the things that were wrong. Maybe things that wronged you or wronged your family or wronged your friends. Let's take Jesus' advice and forgive. Often. Always. Amen?
Amen.
End result, people see him in you. They learn that they are loved unconditionally. And God uses us as an instrument to show them that they're worthy of being loved. Amen. Amen. Please join with me in prayer. Oh, dear Heavenly Father, I know, dear Lord, that sometimes things are done to us that are hurtful. But if we take a look at your Son, if we take a look at the things that were done to him and how he continued to walk towards that cross, and he continued to show your love for us, we could think that it's not so bad. And if we follow his example of showing us love and showing those that have hurt us love also, we will be restored with joy in our hearts. And we will live a life of happiness. We will be blessed as you continue to bless us every day. So I ask you, dear Lord, if there are some of us that are holding things that have been done to us in our hearts, unlock the prison door. And allow us to become humble and let it go. Set us free. I know when we become free, we will never want to be locked up again. We will praise your name and give you all the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you would join with me now in singing Great is Thy Faithfulness, hymn number 1.
Thank you.
joining us for more fellowship down in the fellowship hall and have brunch. So let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for being with us here in the service, and I ask that you continue to be with us as we extend our fellowship time with a meal and conversation. So I ask you, dear Lord, to bless the food, bless the hands that have prepared it, and bless our conversations as we have it. And this I pray, dear Lord, in Jesus' name.